Today we're gonna learn how to work out. Well, how to at least program for a workout, a basic template of the anatomy of a workout, or at least part of it. Okay, you're getting some of the anatomy to create a section of the template to build your own workout. So today we're going to be in the gym for one workout, we're going to be in my garden gym for another workout, and then we're going to be all around where I am right now for the third workout. You'll soon see how we can both follow the exact same template, and yet our workouts can look entirely different. So, let's dive in. So the part we're talking about consists of three things. The part where you're actually generating force, what a lot of people call the workout. The other parts of the workout template, the beginning and the end, the bookends, which I think are very important, deserve their own video. So look for that video soon where we talk about how to let tension go at the beginning and the end of the workout so we can create a bunch of it in the middle. They are just as important as that major force development section in the middle that we're talking about today, but they manifest a lot differently, and so I wanna focus on them in a completely different video. So the part we're talking about consists of three things. If you know anything about the infamous West Side Barbell and the legendary Louis Simmons, who just recently passed, some of this might look a little familiar. Rest in periodization, Louis. I know the Devils and the Angels are all hitting PRs now that you're their coach. Well, despite the fact that a West Side workout might not look anything like stuff I would do, yeah, there are some glaring similarities in that we're trying to develop force in different ways to reach a goal. Louis called the beginning of his workout maximum force development. I call mine maximum skill development. We might not be aiming to generate maximum force, but we are putting all our awareness and presence into building a skill. Chances are, no matter what it is, it's going to be a large amount of force development, but it may also be a huge amount of technical awareness, or a combination of both. This could manifest in so many ways. Maybe you're working on a backflip. That's max skill development. Maybe you're working on a serious heavy squat. That would be max skill development. For instance, in our three workouts today, one of them is a clean and jerk, which is kind of technical, but mostly a lot of oomph. Especially for someone who has some history with it, like I do. I was simply practicing it to get more oomph so I could apply that to my strongman meet coming up, which is now past, and you've seen that video. But the workout we did today featured one-arm pull-up training, which is particularly challenging for me. I have to use some assistant techniques, and I can generally only do one rep at a time because it takes a huge toll on me. So it's the practice of something complicated and technical that also combines a huge amount of force. And then the third workout features what's called a Zercher lift, which is taking something up from the ground. In this case, a big stick with some cinder blocks on it. Not particularly technical, but yes, a whole lot of force development. Working on an important skill might not mean maximum force development, but there's probably going to be a lot of force involved. But it does mean work on presence and awareness. So max skill development is the top of my list. Then we support that. We do something that Louis called, and I've borrowed, repetition method, which means you're going to repeat a movement for multiple reasons. A, to repeat that skill in your brain so your body learns it. It's another chance for awareness and presence. And B, to build some muscle. Good old-fashioned hypertrophy training. When you take your movement training, you combine it with your hypertrophy training, you've got a potent little blend. Unfortunately, we strip the two too often. We're too busy learning something, and then we're too busy doing sloppy shit to build muscles that we never quite combine them. So let's bring the two together to build the muscle, to help the movement, to build the skill. So the repetition method to support my pressing would be a barbell incline press with dangly bits. I talk about dangly bits a lot in other videos, but to sum it up here quickly, I hang some weight on a bar, so when I press, the whole thing moves like crazy. There's a special bar for this called an earthquake bar. You don't need the earthquake bar, you just need stuff dangling off a regular barbell. It's gonna work great. You're not going particularly heavy. In fact, you're going pretty darn light because the wobbly effect is gonna make up for the fact that the load itself is not particularly hard. We've called it a heckle in the past. Imagine you're being heckled while you do the move. Your muscles in many ways will appreciate it. So now the support work. I just hooked one of my Serious Steel fitness bands up into a tree, and I'm just gonna row with it, but it's at an angle. Shoulder, pull down. Everything stays down, then up. You know how a lot of people hit their chest from different angles? They'll do the flat bench and then they'll do the incline and maybe they'll do a decline. I do something similar with push-ups. I'll hit push-ups from different angles, from different heights, from different weird positions. And that's not really to build the muscle in different ways like bodybuilders want to believe. It's more about building your strength from every angle possible. Because our body can get extremely specific and get really good at one thing. Practice makes permanent. What are we making permanent? So being able to have all angles of strength identified can help. In this case, if I'm trying to do something fairly extreme, at least for me, like a one-arm pull-up, I'm gonna bring my back in as many ways as I can so the support work will be angled a little bit. It's not a direct row. I do plenty of those as well, as you know. It's not a pull-up, it's an angled row. Always working on pulling the shoulder blade down, elbow into my back pocket. Several sets, quite a few reps. It's great support work for that one rep max pull-up we did earlier. And then of course, GPP. I have a whole nother video dedicated to that. Go watch it. But in today's case, you're gonna see a couple examples of how I might apply it in a workout. In a gym, with some toys, and out here. Here I combine multiple skills, of which I have a modicum of ability at all of them. I'm not trying to learn anything new here. This is not the time to do that. If I can't do a pull-up, I shouldn't be doing pull-ups here. If I couldn't do a push-up, for instance, I shouldn't be doing push-ups here. This is not the time to be practicing sloppy stuff just to get tired. The goal of GPP is not to get tired. It is, however, to build the capacity to do more. And in that capacity building, we should have multiple skills, because if we just repeat the same skills over and over, we're actually not building our ability to do other things. For instance, if you're just always running on a treadmill, you're just getting good at running on a treadmill. If you're just always doing kettlebell swings, you're actually just getting good at doing kettlebell swings. If you're just doing the same handful of movements over and over again, like certain protocols have the same 12, 15 movements over and over again, you're actually limiting yourself. You're not expanding your ability to do more, you're just getting better at doing those things more. So this is a good chance to work on multiple skills, put them together, combine your capacity to do more, but do them well, be present, be aware, all that stuff. Anyway, what I do here is simply a double kettlebell windmill combo with a inchworm push-up and some pull-ups, and then a backwards crawl. I do something at one end of the gym, get to the other end of the gym, do something there, get back. It's one of the simplest templates I use, and I use it a lot because it's real fun to plug good stuff into it. Something here, move, something here, come back. There are multiple levels, there are multiple positions, there are several different assets that we're throwing in, what I call manipulatable factors that we're manipulating to build a handful of different skills with different levels of force development, all at sort of the same time, building our overall capacity to do more. I feel like I'm babbling on about GPP again, which I've already done in that past video. Please go watch it. But here's a second example of my GPP. I'm just gonna cover some ground and do some random stuff along the way. I'm gonna do some pull-ups, I'm gonna climb a tree, I'm gonna climb a mountain, I'm gonna do some squats. I'm gonna do some pull-ups. Mosey over to my bamboo garden. Do a tree climb. My first experience with this tree was last year when I heard a meow coming from somewhere on the property. And I wandered and wandered through this weird little bamboo maze, hearing it. It was almost like a horror film where you heard a sound, but you could not pinpoint where it's coming from. And then suddenly I looked up, and way up in this tree was a cat. When I was young, my dad said, "Don't worry about cats stuck in trees. You've never seen a cat skeleton up there, have you?" But I'm still a sucker for a crying cat. So up this tree I went, and I've gone several times since. It's now sort of part of my training. Moving on! You may recognize the garden gym from past videos, but we're not using it today. Just gonna walk right past it. Mosey up a very steep hill to get to my turtle rock. This is the famous turtle rock. You may have seen it in past videos. Obviously the turtle rock, because my mom painted it to look like a turtle. So I'm here at the turtle rock so I can bear hug it and squat it, which I think is one of the most important squat styles there is, and I'm gonna make an entire video about that soon. So I climbed up the hill, I'm gonna squat my turtle rock, I'm gonna go back down and do this whole loop a couple more times. On repeat, several cycles. I'm gonna cover some ground, walking around, I'm not gonna run. This isn't high intensity interval training, which is just a fancy way of saying, I'm burning calories doing sloppy reps. That's not fitness. That's calorie burning, not the same thing. Hey, whatever goal you choose is fine and dandy. Just understand that a lot of goals in the name of fitness aren't actually fitness. Burning calories is one of them. Outcome, yes. Byproduct, yes. Goal, no. Skill building, on the other hand, well, you know already what I think about that. And guess what? Oh yeah, all sorts of calories are gonna be burned. But in the meantime, I'm actually doing stuff. In other words, just because we're trying to do more doesn't mean we're gonna do it sloppy or messy. Practice makes permanent. What are we trying to make permanent? That's my GPP today. General physical preparedness, but with purpose, always with purpose. That template, that basic anatomy can look so different in different situations. Mine and yours might be very similar templates, but they might look entirely different as workouts. You and I could utilize the template almost identically, and yet the workouts could look entirely different and have entirely different purposes and create entirely different results. In other words, here's some of the clay to mold your program. What are you gonna do with it? Hey, I hope that helps a little bit. I hope it gave you a few ideas. Thanks for watching. Thanks for inspiring, because you do. Oh, and we'll see you later. Bye. So at the Turtle Rock, so I climbed up the hill, got to my Turtle Rock. I'm going to do this. Wow, the sun just came out. Woo. She's currently lying on my leg. I can't get up.